So the next talk will be given by Yuri Gurevich, and it is on the hidden variables, value and expectation local theorems. Thank you.
So the basic drama is there are hidden variables theorems which attempt to remove quantum mechanics and replace it by the usual probability theory. On the other side, there are no-go theorems, which show that such attempts with hidden variables are fruitless. There are two approaches that we considered. One is the classical value no-go theorems, which go back to Bell and Koch and Specker. And there was a recent wave of work on this issue on expectation no-go theorems. So in the classical case, the no-go theorem says that hidden variables cannot reproduce the quantum mechanical predictions of the possible values of the observables. And in the expectation case, that similarly, you cannot predict the expected values of the measurements. So we got into this by chance. I was reading Specken's paper, and it makes very strong philosophical and ambitious claims, which attracted attention. There were some little errors we tried to fix. Then Emerson wrote to me, oh, we have another bunch of papers. So we looked into those. There was plenty of errors in those. Eventually, in this expectation approach, there is a very strong suggestion that it's more powerful. Eventually, we became to doubt this approach, and some others. Specken's has a thesis that state and measurements are sort of dual. So eventually, we wanted to show that some of these claims are exaggerated, and it's not so easy, because in the value approach, you deal with Hermitian operators as observables. So when you measure one, you get an eigenvalue. In the expectation approach, you use Hermitian, some Hermitian operators as effects, which means members of the P of EMs. And when you measure, you get 0, 1, never mind what eigenvalues are there. So the only Hermitian operators for which these two uses coincide are projections. So we sharpened both approaches. The classical approach is pretty much optimized. So we worked mostly with the expectation approach. We sharpened it to the point that only projections are used, and showed that no, this approach does not imply the value approach. In the process, it turns out that this E approach can be much strengthened and simplified. So in particular, there was a series of papers. Eventually, they proved there are no-go theorems for the infinite dimensional case. But we show that, in fact, the infinite dimensional case follows from finite dimensional cases. So here is, it's probably, I don't have enough time to explain, but this is the optimized version of this exponential, of expectation approach. So you have a measurable space. This is where the hidden variables take values. Without loss of generality, there is one hidden variable. which takes values in this measurable space lambda. Then you have a convex linear map. Convex linearity is reminded below. And eventually, at 4, you see on the left is the prediction of hidden variable theory, and on the right is what quantum mechanics says. So we notice this theorem that if you have a closed subspace and you prove that this expectation approach fails in the subspace, then it also fails in the larger space. So intuitively such things are sort of obvious, but the specific ways that things fail are not so obvious. A little work. So here is the optimized expectation no-load theorem. If the dimension of the Hilbert space is at least 2, you cannot get lower than that, then there is no expectation representation for the quantum system. For the appropriate quantum systems. I actually like Speckens' paper. I still like it. I think it's good to go and make very bold conjectures. And of course, when you make bold conjectures, you take chances. So this idea of duality of state and measurement doesn't quite work. So if we try to reformulate the dual version of our theorem, it does not work. So to bring the classical approach into this mold where you make certain assumptions and prove no-go theorem, so we needed joint spectrum. So remind what joint spectrum is. In the finite dimensional case, it is what you would expect. In the infinite dimensional case, it's a more complicated version. So we reformulate this classical Bell, Koch, and Speckens approach in the following form. So we define what's evaluation. Given a Hilbert space and a bunch of observables, evaluation is a function on the observables such that for every value of these evaluations, so you get the appropriate value from the joint spectrum. Whenever the operators are pairwise commuting. So in the finite dimensional space, when they're pairwise commuting, they're jointly diagonalizable and things are simple. In the infinite dimensional case, it's more complicated story. Again, there exists a bootstrapping theorem. So if you have a closed subspace and you prove the no-go theorem for the closed subspace, then it's also true for the larger space. So Koch, Speckens, and Bell never, I'm sure they would not be surprised, but they never looked into higher dimensional spaces. So neither Bell nor Koch and Speckens formulated their theorems in terms of rank one projections or even just projections. So Bell definitely, Kochensperger definitely speak about a richer observables, but in fact, it is not very far from what they did. So this is the classical value no-go theorem. The dimension should be at least 3. And then in the finite dimensional case, you have no-go theorem that uses only rank 1 projections. In general, this is not true. It's not that we can't prove, we just know that this is not true. You have to use more general projections. And finally, we want to compare the two approaches, and a priori it's quite a strange situation. You have two no-go theorems. You want to prove that one does not imply the other. So normally how would you do that one statement doesn't imply the other? You try to get a model where the other statement holds and the first fails. But we speak about kind of counterfactual worlds where one of the no-go theorems, where one of the no-go theorems fails, and therefore some hidden variable theory succeeds. Fortunately, there is this gap. So in the classical approach, the no-go theorem holds starting from dimension 3, whereas in expectation approach, it starts from dimension 2. So in dimension 2, we have the no-go theorem for the expectation approach, whereas for the value approach, actually there is a hidden variable theory, a successful hidden variable theory constructed by Bell, and building on this theory, we prove that the expectation no-go theorem does not imply the value no-go theorem. That's it.
Any questions, comments? Yes, please.
Can you explain why you say that preparation and measurement are not dual?
So, for example, okay, let's see. In the expectation, when they formulated expectation theory, both groups, they required convex linearity for the states and for the measurement. So, this will be one argument. Because they thought that there is this symmetry between the two. So, it turns out that you don't have to require it for the measurements. We remove that and the theorem survived. If you do the opposite, you remove convex linearity requirements for the states, but keep it for the measurements, there's a quite easy counterexample. So it's actually written in full here. It's a very obvious counterexample. So this is one argument why it doesn't work. So in...
You consider only pure states.
Say it again.
Pure states. In this example, you consider only pure states.
Yes, so this is the dual version. So when you don't require convex linearity for the states, then you remain with pure states. Also, we considered in functional analysis version, there's duality theorems. And they work one way and do not work the other way. That's more involved argument which I cannot give here. So there's a lot of, it's an interesting conjecture, and then it survives, it explains certain things, but not all.
So I was just trying to understand the, can you hear me?
Yes. So you will not get another theorem because there exists a theory sketched by Bell.
Yeah, but that's only for projectors. That's only for that qubit model. It's for projection measurements on a qubit.
Yes.
Right. So if I talk about like non-projective observables, then you cannot embed them in a model which is.
So this is goes beyond our goal.
Okay.
We wanted to show that the expectation approach is not more powerful, and therefore it suffices for us to find one situation where the value, where this theorem is true and this theorem fails.
Right, but that's like
if we don't restrict to projectors, you can compare. They speak about different things.
I mean, there are special cases of POVs, right? In that sense, I guess it's just a matter of interpretation what you mean by it, which is more powerful, because it's. I mean, that last paragraph is well understood. Is all I'm saying. Like I don't think anyone would contradict that. It's just the meaning you give to it, like the fact that one applies the other or not.
You lost me, I don't know.
Yeah, I think you should continue this offline. So we thank the speaker again.